Hey everybody, Professor Snart checking in for our creative writing course here. So we've just finished up Unit 3 on Thursday, February 4th, looking at metaphor, analogy, simile, you know, that analogic language, the language of comparison, some really, really good ones, interesting ones, and so from such a wide variety of things, pop music to the Bible to everything in between. So pretty cool. So we move on to Unit 4, but I also want to draw your attention to our first workshop coming up here in Unit 5. So you may in fact want to pop into Unit 5 just to see how it's set up. Also to review a couple of things here, like how the workshops work in terms of everybody. You'll find yourself in a group now. So Unit 5 has a discussion board with some thread set up. You'll see which thread you're in. You'll have to go in and post your own work, in this case, a fiction workshop. So we're writing a short story. There's no guidelines about subject matter or even really length exactly. It has to be, you know, it has to be something you've invested some time in, probably not totally polished. That's the reason you're looking to get some feedback on it for improvement. But we'd also want to be sort of sensitive to people's time and not post the 60-page epic that you're working on or whatever it might be. So you may want to look forward to this then to see kind of again how it's set up and what you'll be needing to do, but also keep in mind that now is really the time to begin working or to continue working on a short story for that Unit 5. Even the due date's you know, a little ways out and we have another unit to do in between, you wouldn't necessarily want to wait until finishing up Unit 4 and then just give yourself a little bit of time to try to whip up a short story. So you may want to work a little bit ahead when it comes to things like our workshop days. Okay, but let me take a quick look into Unit 4 then, which is another kind of writing exercise unit that I think you'll find pretty fun. So the subtitle here is The Significant Object, which is the, you'll see how that works in the assignment. So we have a reading from our textbook again, some content stuff to look through, ideas about the short story, often very easy to look at just theoretically or, you know, in a visual sort of thing like that. But again, ideas that I'll be looking for the application of in your own work or in some ways like a way of thinking about crafting stories that maybe you haven't really thought of so much before. There's some more stories to read here and especially to think about how maybe the theoretical side of basically building a short story either works or sometimes doesn't work exactly in the short stories that we're looking at. So I'm going to ask you to read a very, very short story by Hemingway that's in our handbook there. And then there's one that I'm providing via ebook, which you may not show up correctly, but I'll have it show up correctly here. I'll also provide a link so you can get right to it. It's a pretty famous one called Hands by Sherwood Anderson. So again, it'll show up as a nice e-text that you can read through right here. Looking for, again, not so much even to analyze it like we might have to do for an essay, but to really think about these as the product of writers, just like we are, working through some of the problems of fiction, like how do you present ideas? How do you build a character? How do you have characters interact and all that kind of stuff? Part of what you'll read about in our textbook, but also in the content in the other folder about sort of like the elements or the theory of the short story. So there's no assignment here per se, other than just to read the theoretical stuff and then to read some other short stories and see if the theory plays out or how these writers kind of follow the rules, break the rules, and all that kind of stuff. And then we have our assignment down here in the final folder, Significant Objects. Okay, so Significant Objects, the idea is that you find what's called a tchotchke, a sort of valueless memento, a little doohickey that you own. So don't just Google this and do it that way. It has to be a thing like a physical object that you can actually pick up and turn around and look at all the pieces of it and feel what it's like and all that sort of stuff. And so there's, again, an audio piece that you can listen to and also a couple of links to the website. So there was this book written, and it was called Significant Objects. And what the authors wanted to do, you'll see that the audio occurs in it's from a radio show called Marketplace. So why is this show about economics having to do with, you know, fiction writing. So what these authors wanted to do is see if they could take tchotchkes, these basically valueless objects, and have writers write a backstory for them, a totally fictitious backstory, like they have magical powers, they're from the 8th century, they whatever, right? Totally made up. And then auction them on eBay, and so to add value. Now, like the authors will say, they weren't trying to fool anybody. They overtly said that the fiction that was connected with the objects was completely made up. They weren't trying to trick people into buying like magic objects or anything like that. And so some of the objects went from being basically valueless to selling for $5, $10, like $100 in some cases. So admittedly, there's all kinds of things that that we're not really going to think about in terms of, like, do people then buy it for the name of the author? Like, if the author is well known, then that sort of adds value. It's not really the story. We're not going to worry about that part. It's just sort of interesting to me, this whole idea that if you told an interesting story about something, even totally made up, it all of a sudden kind of grows in value. It's sort of empowering to think about from the writer's perspective that we would, like, be able to do that. So your assignment then is to basically do the same thing. You're going to take a picture of your tchotchke, and again, don't just Google something from the web. I want it to be an actual thing that you own, because you're going to write a backstory for it. You're going to give it value by telling us its history, totally made up, of course. But part of what you want to do, and part of what you'll see in some of the examples here, is how the writers will often use details from the thing itself, like the way it feels or how it's built or the actual pieces of it, to construct or make reference to in the stories that they tell. So you don't just want to have a static picture, you want to have the actual thing. So you know what size it is, again, how it sort of feels and looks from all angles, so that you can work those details into the story that you tell. So one of the things that that is really important here is to avoid telling a story a little bit like the therapeutic writing, that the thing has value, and you're trying to sell it, remember, you're trying to sell it to somebody else. The thing has value because your grandma gave it to you and you really love your grandma. That's valuable for you, but it's not really valuable for anybody else. It's not a very interesting backstory. So we need something, again, made up that's going to appeal to somebody who doesn't know you or know your grandmother or anything like that. And that's what gives the thing its value. And you'll notice that, again, in many of the examples, it's a very short story that they write, sort of like flash fiction almost. It's like a page. It's not very long. So you have to be really thoughtful about what details you include. So you can't give us this super long narrative about every day in the life of this tchotchke. You kind of have to pick the details that really make the thing, right, pop, that make it impactful. Using descriptive language, obviously you're being creative, but staying within this fairly limited word count. And of course, again, you're not telling us that real story, right? Okay, let's see what else. Oh, of course, include the picture then, so we get to see it. And remember the reply component here. So a few folks seem to be forgetting that on a fairly regular basis. So time management here, right? We got to finish these units in a timely manner, and you've got to get those replies done as well. You can't be doing it at the last minute, throwing stuff together. It sort of defeats the purpose of taking the class, really. So if there's anything that I can do to, as far as keeping people on track, by all means, reach out to me and let me know. And hopefully you have fun with the significant objects assignment here. Again, don't just Google a picture, like don't Google tchotchke. Use something that you've actually got, and don't lie. Yeah, I know you've got one in your house somewhere. All right. So be in touch with questions or concerns, and I look forward to reading everyone's significant object backstory.